for some reason the door was locked when we got here and left at 6:15, and it took about 6:40 to get the door unlocked. So just thrilled to have this many people here at our February lecture, or January lecture. Welcome to the faculty lounge at UBEI. My name is Lori Brinklow. I'm the coordinator at the Institute of Island Studies, which is just down the hallway. And if anybody needs to go to the washroom, you'll go right by our offices and you'll see our great big Islands Institute of Island Studies stained glass that's on the wall. And so we are a public policy education research institute here at UBEI. Anything to do with islands, Prince Edward Island and other small islands, is what we're all about. We do public forums, we do regular lecture series, we do conferences, all to do with islands. And if you're not, I'll get Jim to stand up in a couple of seconds to introduce something, but we also have a Master of Arts in Island Studies program, and this is how tonight's lecture came about, was to have one of our students come and speak about her research. So Jim, do you want to stand up? Jim is the chair of the executive committee of the Institute of Island Studies, so Jim Randall.
Thank you very much. Lori is really the public face of the Institute of Island Studies, and it's a much better public face than I would ever make, of course. But I just wanted to welcome you all here as well. And I do have a sign-up sheet. I know many of you have already signed this. As Lori has suggested, that we have a lot of public-based events, whether that's monthly lecture series, public symposia, or even conferences and meetings that are open to the public as well. And so we won't bombard you with notices, but if you do want to get on this so you don't miss something, and hey, we haven't signed up already, I'd encourage you to put your name and your email address down here and pass it around to the back and then flip it over to the other side and we'll pick it up at the end of the evening. So have a good evening and welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. So we had, we started our lecture last October and we had three leading up to Christmas, and now for January 2017 we have Erin Rowan and Erin Beaglaoich. So Erin, as I mentioned, is a student in our Master of Arts in Island Studies program, and she grew up in Charlottetown, did her undergraduate degree here in science, but this woman has such curiosity for other things than science that she switched into arts. And so we're really happy to get her. She did some courses through the Master of Arts in Island Studies program and was one of my students, and I just, I'm her supervisor, her co-supervisor for her master's degree, and I'm very excited to hear about her research on Ireland. And joining her at some point, they've got it figured out, is Eoin Beaglaoich over here, who is an Irish scholar. We decided to do the focus on Ireland, and it was just a bonus, two bonuses. One, that Eoin is here for the year, doing working at UPEI, teaching Irish Gaelic and Irish culture, and also is the musician in residence at Holland College. And it just was a coincidence that, well, for me a coincidence, maybe not, that actually Eoin is from the very, or his mom is from the area, and he just is from one county over where Erin is doing her research. So it was a wonderful connection of synchronicity, synergy between the two pieces of Erin's research and Owen's own experience, plus his lovely knowledge of Ireland. I've gotten to sit in on a couple of meetings with him, and he's very, of course, knowledgeable about Ireland. He's from there. Plus, it's fun to listen to your accent. So I will pass it over to Erin, and we'll begin.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. Thank you all for coming here. You're all very welcome. My name is Erin, and as Dr. Lori said, I'm a student of Island Studies program here at UPEI, and my presentation tonight is Isle of Hunger, Isle of Pain, the Great Famine in Cathair Sabine and Valentia Island, County Kerry, Ireland. Now, my project is a comparison of famine experience and folk memory in Cathair Sabine and Valentia Island, County Kerry. This is my thesis project for my MA degree here at UPEI. And last year, I was fortunate enough to travel to Ireland and spend 6 weeks there on a research visit in March and April. And this trip was sponsored by the Ireland Canada University Foundation's Flaherty Scholarship Program. While in Ireland, I conducted semi-structured interviews with the locals from Camaradh and Valentia Island. I was able to access primary and secondary sources at the various libraries and archives in County Kerry and throughout Ireland. And I was also able to visit some important historical sites connected to the famine, both locally and nationally. The local ones, which I'll talk a little bit more about later, is were the Carrasabeen Workhouse, the Srugreina Cemetery, and Kilreelig Famine Village. And I was able to also visit some famine monuments in Limerick, Dublin, and Murrisk. And this picture here is a picture of the National Famine Memorial in Murrisk, County Mayo, which suffered heavily during the famine. And the memorial is of a coffin ship, which there was widespread immigration during the famine out of Ireland. And the ships that took the immigrants were often referred to as coffin ships because of the incredibly low survival rate of the passengers on the ship. So it's a little difficult to see with this picture, but it's a ship with skeletons representing the passengers and victims of the famine sort of woven into the woodwork of the ship. So I began my trip in Ireland in the city of Limerick, in County Limerick, here, and then traveled south down to County Kerry in the southwest of Ireland. This is County Kerry here in the Carrasabeen and Valentia Island down there. Now, in order to properly understand the famine in Ireland, it's important to look at the conditions in the country leading up, in the years leading up to the famine. And these are marked by a number of characteristics, one of them being the landlord-tenant relationship at the time. So the land in Ireland was owned primarily by Protestants, and many of these landowners were absentee landlords. So they had various land agents who would oversee their land, collect their rents from the tenants who rented the land and worked the land. Now, for the tenants, there was no incentive for them to make any improvements to their land or to their home, because as soon as they made any improvements, their rents and taxes would be raised. For example, at the time, there was a tax on windows, so if you see any houses from that period still standing in Ireland, they'll often just have one very small, tiny window for the house, and that's because of that window tax. Now, for the landlords, any piece of land that they owned with a rent of more than £4 annually, the tenants were responsible for paying the taxes on that land. However, any pieces of land worth less than £4, the landlord was responsible for paying those taxes. So there was an incentive on the part of the landlord to get rid of their smaller tenants with smaller pieces of land. That way they could amalgamate the lands into bigger, more profitable farms. So as a tenant in pre-famine Ireland, one's life depended very heavily on the landlord from whom you rented your land. In the early part of the 19th century, Ireland also saw a very rapid increase in population. As you can see from this graph here, at 1800, the population was approximately 5.5 million people in Ireland. By 1841, which is 4 years before the potato blight hit, the population had reached just over 8 million people. So we saw a huge exponential growth in population. And this is because of the widespread poverty in the country at the time. Because the people were so poor and because they had so few options, people tended to marry very young and have large families, who in turn married young and had large families. So we see this cycle of poverty repeating itself, which leads to this huge increase in population. Now, it's interesting to note that the population currently in Ireland is only 4.5 million people. So you can see with a population of 8 million, just how densely populated and overpopulated the country would have been at that time. There was also an act put in place called the Gavelkind Act, put in place by Queen Anne of England in 1703. And this act stated that when a Catholic tenant died, his land was to be split equally between all of his sons. if his eldest son were to convert to the Protestant faith, he would then receive the entire portion of the land. And this law was designed to reduce Catholic land ownership and thereby Catholic power in Ireland. And because of the high marriage rate and the high birth rate, the land became more and more divided. So you had more and more people living on increasingly smaller plots of land. This led to a dependence on the potato crop, because the potato was the only crop that could sustain such large families on such small pieces of land. Any other crops, such as grain or animals that were raised, were all sold to pay the tenant's rent. And we did see isolated famines in 1821 and 22 in the provinces of Munster and Connacht, and in 1830 and 1831 in counties Mayo, Donegal, and Galway. So before the potato blight hit, there was already widespread poverty throughout the country, and when the blight hit, things quickly went from bad to worse. Now, the potato blight first hit Ireland in 1845, and it devastated the potato crops in 45 and 46, which resulted in widespread starvation throughout the country. At the end of the famine in 1852, approximately 1 million people were dead from starvation and disease, and another 1 million had emigrated mainly to North America, to Australia. Now, although the potato crops did fail, the other crops continued to grow. However, these were mostly exported out of Ireland. So it's interesting to note that even during some of the worst years of the famine, food continued to be exported in large amounts out of Ireland. When I conducted my interviews in Ireland, I asked people what they thought the causes for the famine were, and one person identified or said that it was the splitting of the land, really, that was the cause of the famine. The farms were so small that they were only a couple of acres, so they had no land, only enough to grow potatoes. They had nothing, so when the potato failed, everything failed. So this refers back to the Gavelkind Act that caused the land to be divided, and then which in turn caused the dependence on the potato. Another person says, popular belief is that because the potatoes failed, this caused the famine. It didn't. Because people were very badly off at the time, small tenant farmers and that. It was policy to get rid of the peasants from Ireland. It was simple as that. Let them die or let them emigrate, it didn't matter. So this person identified the lack of government action during the famine as the cause for the famine being as severe and devastating as it was, referring to the amount of food that was exported and identifying the enormous peasant class in Ireland at that time that presented a problem for the British, and the blight offered a convenient solution. So this is a map of County Kerry here. So on the Eboruagh Peninsula here, you have Carrigsaveen here, and then approximately 1 mile away is the small island of Valentia Island. One of the important local sites connected to the famine in Carrigsaveen is the Carrigsaveen Workhouse. The workhouse was originally built in 1833 as a private residence by Charles O'Connell for his wife Kate, who was the daughter of Daniel O'Connell. Daniel O'Connell was born in Carrigsaveen, and he's known throughout Ireland as the Liberator because of his campaigning for Catholic emancipation. The workhouse was eventually converted into a workhouse, and it opened its doors first in 1844, so 1 year before the famine. And it had a capacity for 400 inmates. However, in 1848, at the height of the famine, 1,241 inmates were recorded living in the workhouse. And the workhouse was described to me by many of the people I interviewed as a last resort for people who were evicted from their land, who were too ill to work, who had no place else to go. And upon entering the workhouse, the families were immediately separated. The men had separate quarters from the women, and the boys had separate quarters from the girls, so families were broken up. And the inmates were expected to work while they were in the workhouse. So the men worked cutting stone, building walls, building roads, while the women spun and knitted. And there was also a school and chapel in the workhouse that the children attended. The workhouse was also used as a prison during the Irish Civil War in 1922-23, which makes it an important landmark locally for that reason as well. It's currently privately owned, with no plans for restoration. And when I asked about restoration, the woman who owns the land and the workhouse said that there has never been funding to recreate it, but that I think people hadn't the appetite for recreating something that was so sad. So this is a picture of the workhouse here. As you can see, it's fallen into disrepair. And then this field in front with these stone walls, this would have been a typical example of work done by the inmates. They would have cleared the field of those stones and they would have built the walls around the field and then worked the field. This was the workhouse infirmary here. It's currently being used as a horse stable, but this is where anyone who is too ill to work would go. Now, approximately 1 mile from the workhouse is a cemetery called Srubrena Cemetery, and this was the burial site for any of the workhouse inmates who died, and they would have been carried there by other workhouse inmates for burial. Some of the graves are marked by plain stones, but most of them are unmarked. And there is a memorial plaque in the graveyard that was established for famine victims in 1996, so 150 years after the famine. And the memorial was done by the owners of the workhouse and students from the local primary school. This is a picture of the cemetery here. So you can see all of these stones here denote graves. And as the woman who gave me the tour said, it really does denote the vast number of people who are scattered everywhere. And if you look beyond the cemetery, you can get a sense of what the landscape of the area looks like. So this low-lying land here, this is all peat bogs. And then, as you can see, it's also very mountainous. So between the peat bogs and the mountains is a very small strip of agriculturally viable land, but there's really not a whole lot of arable land. This is a picture of the plaque, the memorial plaque. This stone down here was taken from the workhouse and there's a plaque inscribed on it which reads, "Pray for us, the people who died during the famine and are buried in this graveyard, erected by the children of Cora's National School, July 3rd, 1996. Another site that I visited was located just outside of Carsvein, and it's Kewreelig Famine Village. This is a small coastal village established in 1790, and it was eventually deserted in the 1950s. However, in 1991, it was restored for use as an artist retreat for local and international artists. So artists can apply for grants to come and work and stay in these restored famine cottages for several weeks, and then any art that they create during that time is presented and auctioned off at the Kewreelig Gallery, and then the proceeds go back to the village. So this is a picture of Kewreelig here, which really shows the harshness and the wildness of the landscape, and it brings to life how difficult it must have been trying to make a living on such a landscape. This is a picture of a restored cottage. Here you can see the very small window there to the right and the door, a very simple construction, and it's been restored. And that's where the artists stay whenever they receive grants to come there. Now, in terms of comparing the famine experience in Carsvein and on Valentia Island, overall, Valentia saw less extreme conditions than in Carsvein. This is due to several factors. The first being that most of Valentia Island was owned by a landlord who's called the Knight of Kerry. And he was a resident landlord, which was atypical for the the time. Most landlords were absentee. However, the Knight of Kerry actually lived on the island, so he would have seen firsthand what was going on during the famine. And the Knight of Kerry is extremely highly regarded by all the islanders, even to this day. They regard him very highly. By contrast, Carzadine was owned mostly by Trinity College in Dublin, and they were notoriously bad landowners. Absentee, a lot of different land agents doing their work for them. And one of those land agents was actually Daniel O'Connell, who, as I mentioned, is a very respected figure in Ireland and is very highly regarded today as a landlord, despite some attempted slander by the London Times. So during the famine, the London Times sent over a reporter and an artist to sketch pictures of Daniel O'Connell's lands and attempt to slander him as a landlord and as somebody who claimed to care about the rights of his people, and yet look how poorly his tenants are living. However, it wasn't successful, and he's still very highly regarded today. Another difference would be the access to the sea. Now, Valentia as an island had better access to the sea and to its resources, and they had a more established fishing industry at the time the famine hit. They had better equipment, and they're just better equipped to work the oceans. This fishing wasn't so well established in Carzadine, and they had more difficult access to the waters. It's set a little bit away from the water, and the waters around the town are quite shallow, so not very viable fishing grounds. And many of the people in Carzadine had to resort to selling their fishing equipment for money to buy food during the famine. There's also no workhouse on Valentia Island, so any poor who required the work would have gone to the Carzadine workhouse. Valentia also had an important industry in the form of a slate quarry during the time of the famine, and the slate was exported outside of Ireland, and they had some fairly high-profile clients, such as Westminster Abbey, the London Houses of Parliament, and the Paris Opera House, all had Valentia slate in them. And the Knight of Kerry, during the famine, he established approximately 200 more jobs at the quarry, just to give people a little bit more work and a chance to earn money during the famine, which is one of the reasons why he's so well regarded. So in the case of Carzadine and Valentia Island, it seems that islandness acted almost as a buffer to the devastation of the famine. Because Valentia was removed, and because it was a desirable and fertile location, it resulted in having a resident landlord and strong industries. And this is the picture of Valentia Island here. And you can see the landscape is much different from Carzadine. Even though it's not very far away, it's a lot more fertile. There's a lot more arable land, and that certainly helped as well during the famine. Now, although Valentia did come through the famine comparably well, it did see the closing of the slate quarry post-famine. When the slate quarry closed, a large number of the islanders found themselves unemployed. So the Knight of Kerry's solution to this was to institute a free or paid immigration scheme. So what that involved is families were offered free passage to America. They were given a small monetary compensation and a small travel package consisting of, you know, clothes or other essentials. Now, the catch to this immigration scheme was that the whole family had to go. Family couldn't send one person to North America and have them pay remittances back to the family in Ireland. The entire family had to go as a unit to receive this free immigration. And if the Knight of Kerry wasn't paying your way, it's likely you couldn't afford to go. So this calls the Knight of Kerry's reputation into some question. So was he as good, as sympathetic as he is remembered to be, or was it merely convenient for him to have islanders working his slate quarry until it closed, and then it wasn't so convenient for him to have them anymore? And one of the people that I've been interviewing put it as, the cottiers weren't nothing to him, but it was in his interest to get rid of them as well. and yet he was regarded as a good landlord. Lansdowne and those in Kenmare were regarded as bad landlords. What must they have been like? Another thing that was identified during my interviews was the use of the famine as future motivation and reasoning for an independent Irish state and government. One of the people I interviewed said it stirred a lot of the revolutionaries in 1916. They were thinking back to the famine. So this 1916 refers to the Easter Rising in April 1916 in Dublin, when Ireland declared itself to be an independent state from Britain. The British Army put the rebellion down several days later, but the Republic of Ireland was eventually established in 1921 with the signing of the Anglo-Irish Treaty. There are also marks on the landscape that are associated with the famine that continue to be used today. The Pauper's Road refers to a road outside of Carrasaveen near the workhouse and the cemetery, and this was the road that when people from Valentia or other areas of Kerry would travel up the river to Carrasaveen, they'd be dropped at this road, and this is the road that they would walk to get to the workhouse. And because these people were so destitute, starving, ill, and referred to as the Pauper's Road, and it's still referred to as that today. And then the other example is the Butter Road, which is a road from Kerry into Cork. And this was a road that people would walk carrying their butter that they'd taken to Cork and trying to sell their butter during the famine. So the memory of the famine still persists in Ireland today, although it is at times a reluctant memory. Now, before I conclude, I'd just like to acknowledge the Atlantic Canada University Foundation and express my gratitude for their support of my research. My trip to Ireland would not have been nearly as successful without their support, so I'm very grateful for it. And this is another picture of Kilrealeigh Village here, a little higher up. Again, you can see it's a beautiful landscape, but it's very harsh and wild as well. So that concludes my presentation for this evening. Thank you all for listening.
Like to come on up and then carry on, and then we'll do questions at the end for both of you, if that works fine.
Great. Good. Another round of applause for Erin, maybe. That will buy me a few seconds as I look at the email. Now I'm going to log you out, Laurie, if that's okay.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't see it. I rang my father today just to see if he had any stories. He's a great man for songs and stuff like that. He's an incredible memory for stuff he learned in school. He left school when he was 14 I asked him about the Gorta Moor. Hang on, my multitasking is terrible. One thing at a time. Okay.
I've almost got the spelling of your name down without having to look.
I just about have it myself. Maybe you could talk amongst yourselves. I'll be 1 or 2 minutes here. See the cursor, I can't see it anymore.
Is it gone?
I don't see the cursor, is it?
Oh, there it is.
Okay, he's alive. Okay.
Just wondering if anybody has a question for Erin right off the top of your head, burning to ask. That would be fantastic while Eoin is setting up here.
Mike.
Was it the knight, the fairy, the name of the landlord in Valencia?
Yes.
Yeah. So when he was encouraging families to leave, what was the, how was that his benefit, that he didn't have to take care of them anymore?
Exactly. He wasn't responsible for them anymore, because as the landlord, he did have some responsibility for their welfare and well-being, and so it got them off of his land. He could use his land for, you know, raising sheep, which was more profitable at the time than,
right,
than keeping peasants on it. Yeah, so it was to his benefit to clear his lands.
And did he have actual contacts in North America that he knew where they were going to? Or?
I'm not sure, actually. I don't know. There were two ships that left, and I believe they were bound for the same destination, but
what were the names of the ships?
The Belgravia and the Furnacia were the two ships.
And those seem to be, I had the privilege of reading all of Erin's transcripts, and everybody is able to name those ships,
yeah,
right? You know, how many generations later it's ingrained in people's minds. Yeah. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Even though
thank
I just
you
thought of something else. I just thought of putting on the maps, Google Maps, to show you better. But that'll take a sec, that's fine.
Okay.
I don't think I'd ever be quite 100% ready for anything in this life. Well, I rang my father and I asked him, did he have any stories or songs from Ungartha Mór? Ungartha Mór in Irish is the Great Famine. And he said, without thinking, oh, I've been here in the studio with Donna Hennessy, the guitar player who's got a studio in West Kerry, himself and Lawrence Courtney, a great singer from West Kerry who has never recorded, and they've been nagging him for years to get into the studio, so finally they have them in the studio. But he said, in Irish to me anyway, oh, we've got them over here since morning, they've been there all day, they haven't had even a cup of tea from poor Donna. So, anyway, he wasn't able to really give me much in terms of songs and stuff. Songs and poems from the famine, Erin was saying, I can't remember the quote, but it was something like, it was just too sad to revisit,
yes,
basically. And there's a wealth of songs and poetry and prose in Irish language and in English. Great songs in the tradition, but from that era, there are songs, but nothing really that deals directly with the famine. So, there's a lot of tabs open here. Just a quick taster here. This is an excerpt from a description of his tour in Ireland. This is a person called Gustave de Beaumont in the 1830s. So imagine, can you see that? Okay. No.
Really, you have to read it.
Well, I think I'll read it anyway.
Yeah.
Imagine four walls of dried mud, which the rain as it falls eerily restores to its primitive condition, having for its roof a little straw or some sods, for its chimney a hole cut in the roof, or very frequently the door through which alone the smoke finds an issue. A single apartment contains father, mother, children, and sometimes a grandfather and a grandmother. There is no furniture in the wretched hovel, a single bed of straw serves the entire family. Five or six half-naked children may be seen crouched near a miserable fire, the ashes of which cover a few potatoes, sole nourishment of the family. In the midst of all lies a dirty pig, the only thriving inhabitant of the place, for he lives in filth. The presence of a pig in an Irish hovel may at first seem an indication of misery. On the contrary, it is a sign of comparative comfort. Indigence is still more extreme in a hovel where no pig is found. I have just described the dwelling of. We've been signed out of this account. Okay. That's fine. I've just described the dwelling of the Irish farmer or agricultural labourer. That's pre-famine. Just to give you an idea of the kind of conditions before the famine hit at all. What the poverty would have been like. It's another account. There's a lot of good accounts at this ancestry.com. Some of the overall impacts of the famine included, well, the decline of the Irish language and customs. In 1835, the number of native Irish speakers was estimated at 4 million. In 1851, only 2 million spoke Irish as their first language. The devastation of the landless laborer class and small tenant farmer, which is the asterisk there. That should be on a different line, sorry. A treeless landscape in many parts of Ireland, the shells of homes that were rendered uninhabitable after the landlords evicted their tenants, a massive decrease in farms of 15 acres and less. The 1841 census showed that 45% of land holdings were less than 5 acres, and Irish immigrants scattered around the globe. Today there are over 5 million people in Ireland, give or take, while it is estimated that there are upwards of 70 million people of Irish descent throughout the globe. Finally, the British government on the famine. The judgment of God sent the calamity to teach the Irish a lesson. That calamity must not be too much mitigated. The real evil with which we have to contend is not the physical evil of the famine, but the moral evil of the selfish, perverse, and turbulent character of the people. That was Sir Charles Trevelyan, head of famine relief at the time. He was a sympathetic soul, as you say, yeah. I suppose part of Erin's thing was, I've left on my jacket, by the way, I'm probably the only one who finds it cold here, but you'll forgive me. One of the things Erin says, touched on, was the consciousness, how it affects the Irish consciousness. It seemed to hit very hard. Of course it would, with the amount of people. A million who died, perished, a million who went, who emigrated. The Irish language, you could say, was symbolic of that. The confidence, the Irish self-confidence, suffered hugely. What good was Irish to you if your lot really was to probably end up in Springfield, Massachusetts, go emigrate to England, to Boston, wherever it was. So the Irish has in